Gurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupaha Kadamayam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurum Vaishnavamsya Shri Rupam Sagrachatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhamvitamsya Namam Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swami Nitinamini Namaste Sarasvate Deve Gauravan Charine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Namo Mahavadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namane Gauratushe Namaha Panchatatvatmakam Krishnam Bhaktarupasvarupakam Bhaktavataram Bhaktakyam Namami Bhaktashaktikam He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dinabandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpataru Bhyasya Kripa Sindhu Bevacha Paditanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasadi Gaura Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare So we welcome all the devotees and guests who have spared their valuable summer evening, summer afternoon to come and spend time here hearing the glories of Krishna and engaging in different acts of devotional service. So today we are continuing the Dashavtar series, and today we are going to discuss on the second incarnation, that is the Kurma avatar, the tortoise incarnation. So this, the incarnation, the pastimes of this incarnation are explained in the 8th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, and narration as explained by Shukadev Goswami to Parikshit Maharaj. Each of these pastimes are explained in response to a intense eagerness. The exchange of wisdom takes place on the pretext of mutual participation. Therefore, the Srimad Bhagavatam or the Bhagavad Gita is a dialogue, it's a samvad. It is not a satsang. Generally, we think that it was a satsang program, Krishna is giving a class to Arjuna. Actually, it was a samvad, it was a discussion. And the discussion was dependent on the situation around, the circumstances, but the dialogue made it more relevant. The solution, the conclusion became more evident after a mutual dialogue. And therefore here also Parikshit Maharaj is engaging in a dialogue with Srila Sukadeva Goswami. So here we will understand how two great souls interact with each other. Though it was a question of a personal salvation for Parikshit, who was about to die in 7 days, his questions were not related to his personal liberation. Nor did Arjun ask questions in the Bhagavad Gita, in the conversation, which were related or suitable to his happiness or his own personal gain. Both these dialogues were engaged for the benefit and the welfare of the entire human society, which would do welfare for the entire world. And therefore, the responsible discussion leads to a responsible conclusion. And anyone who becomes the audience of responsible conclusion also becomes responsible. Right? And therefore, it is the responsibility of the audience also to take up this responsibility which actually brought about this wonderful Bhagavatam. This is how we repay the debt. Suppose a mother and a father gives birth to a child. How can child repay back that debt of being given birth? Can the child give birth back again to the father and mother? No. That means the child is in debt. Something you receive which you cannot pay back. You become indebted. So what do? You also try to give to others who may not be able to repay you back. And that's how you pay back the debt. And therefore, we have debt to these great rishis and sages and great mahatmas who have given us this valuable jewels of spiritual wisdom. So therefore, the katha begins with Parikshit also asking a question. And then when there is a war between the devatas and the danavas, and before that the description of the manus come. So here the question is asked by Parikshit Maharaj, but why and how did the great churning of the milk ocean took place? And for what reason did the Lord stay in the water as a great incarnation? And how did the devatas get the nectar? And what all things were produced? So when these questions were asked by Parikshit, Shukadeva Goswami has begun to explain the Samudra Manthan Leela. And therefore, the pastime begins with Shukadeva Goswami explaining that once when Indra was riding on an elephant, his elephant carrier Airavat, he, Durvasmani was very courteous enough and he actually gave a garland to Indra, thinking that he will bless Indra with his garland. Indra gave the garland to Airavat, the elephant. The elephant did not know what to do with the garland. The elephant took that garland, put beneath his legs and trampled it. And as a result of that, Durvasmani was offended, though not a single word was exchanged. Offense does not have to take place when we exchange words. Just by the conduct enough, there is a refinement. All the offenses which were performed by Indra did not actually involve any words. Brihaspati came to his assembly. He was busy. He was not sensitive enough to realize the presence of the great sage and reciprocate accordingly. So it is not in this world. In this world we require so many things to be told. The days of culture and the era of Sanskriti, everything would be just very sensitively sensed through the conduct of character. That was that subtle, and the effect of that subtle was pronounced. Pleasing would bring upon great reaping, great prosperity, peace, satisfaction, and offending would create great havoc, and it happened here. Even Parikshit Maharaj did not say a word to the sage. He garlanded with a dead serpent. No words were exchanged, and yet Parikshit is sitting on a curse to die within 7 days. So here it is said that Indra could not be sensitive enough to understand and respect, and therefore he lost the strength. And the Dana was at the same time had pleased Shukracharya very nicely. And therefore they became powerful. Today also we'll see the Danavas have become very powerful. Right? We should not blame them. Right? Why are they becoming so powerful? Why is Krishna not doing something? Devotees of Krishna have to do something. Right? And if they follow, anyone who follows, like Duryodhan did a Vaishnava Yajna, which even Yudhishthira Maharaj couldn't do. They were very, very, very dharmic. Ravan was a very dharmic person. And he followed all the rituals, all the brahmanical duties. He was a Brahman. He was a very learned Brahman. So imagine, anyone who would follow the codes and conduct of the Dharma or Vedas would become powerful. Veda or Dharma are not partial. Who is coming to get what? Anyone who takes and follows becomes benefited. And anyone who doesn't take and doesn't apply becomes a loser. And therefore Danavas had a great advantage just because they had fulfilled and pleased Shukracharya so nicely. And therefore Indra wanted to delegate gratitude, a favor to his elephant Airavat. And therefore gratitude cannot be delegated. Something done nice to you has to be reciprocated by you only. You cannot say, on my behalf, this person or this society or they will do it. Therefore, under the influence of madness, of thinking that I am very powerful and I am very wealthy, one may take the liberty to delegate our soul responsibilities, our singular responsibilities. And therefore, when one tries to delegate things which are not delegatable, then the impact comes on and the consequences are seen. So the Danavas, the demons defeated the demigods, and all of them were bereft of prosperity, their kingdom, their position, their prestige, and all of them went to Brahma. In fact, they went to Brahma, and the Brahma was in meditation, and he was aware of that situation, that the demons have become unnecessarily powerful. And therefore, the demons, because they are involved just for their own selfishness, in this world there is more energy of the demons because they are very much selfishly oriented. Why? Because there is a reward for oneself. And suppose if there is no reward, then there is no impetus. So maybe the impetus for the devas have to be for the welfare of the world. If the impetus for the welfare of the world is not stronger than the collective impetus of selfish interests of the demons, then this situation, like the cosmic imbalance which took place where the demons got an upper hand, will happen in human society also. So right now you find the demonic forces of lust, greed, anger, exploitation, and many other anomalies are taking upper hand in society. So this is our samvad. How will Bhagavat come to the rescue of this situation? How will the right or the just forces become reinstated again in the position of being doing welfare for everyone? And therefore, this is how Prabhupada mentions in the purport, Srila Rupa Goswami also left all their positions, prestige, facilities, just so that they can go to Vrindavan, Lokanam Hitakarinam Tribhuvanam. That means they can do welfare for the people, masses, for generations. Welfare cannot be immediate. That welfare is moksha. That welfare is personal. That welfare is selfish. While welfare which counts the legacy is actually paropkar. Bharat Bhumite Janma Hoilo Jar, Janma Sarthak Kari, Kar Paropkar. So to do welfare to others means may not necessarily include your selfish interest. Just because you are doing good to others, all good may happen to you is not necessarily true. The way we think. And therefore, we find that here, Brahmaji is concerned about the welfare of the generations, and therefore Kurma Avatar that takes place in the future verses to come is actually setting that strong foundation for the welfare of everyone. Vishnu provides that foundation, and the devatas have to cooperate with the plan of Vishnu. Then Lokanam Hitakarinam Tribhuvanam. That means Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami and all those his Goswamis, they actually did not go out and spread the message by maybe like having temples or satsang programs or something like that. What was their main instruction? The main instruction was to discover holy places of pilgrimage, at the same time write books. When we say books are the basis, this foundation was established by the six Goswamis of Vrindavan who did not do anything but write books. Why? Because those books will become the future guide, the guide for the future generations of humanity to follow the code of conduct of dharma and bhakti, by which the just forces will become reinstated. Therefore, a template or foundation is always required. And the greatest sacrifice takes place in creating that foundation. And when that foundation was destroyed and disturbed, when Duryodhan and company were about to launch that great war, were able to trying to usurp the entire property from the Pandavas, it was Krishna who wanted to reinstate that foundation again by keeping Pandavas in the center of Dharmaraj, the rule of Dharma. Why? Because every generation that was to come in Duryodhan's kingdom was going to become devoid of all the facility to practice the right conduct of life suited to liberation and then further emancipation towards devotion. So therefore, here we find that Brahma is coming and Brahma is concerned. Why? Because he is supposed to take care of the entire cosmic situation, and not finding the devatas in proper positions where they cannot accept the results of the sacrifices, no good can happen without a good foundation. Therefore, no yajna, no sacrifice, no exchange, no cooperation, and only hoarding, only selfish gain. People, everyone trying to see. The whole world is trying to see what is my interest. No one is trying to see the interest of Krishna. No one is trying to see the interest of the universe. No one is trying to interest of the society. And therefore, Krishna is telling Arjun that your pretext of not fighting the war is so-called good, but actually you're trying to escape the situation by trying to see your own self-interest. And Prabhupada said, the real self-interest lies in interest of Vishnu. So when we change our interest from self to Krishna's interest, then the discourse begins. Then the responsibility begins. Then the right thought process begins. And therefore, the proper disposition to hear Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam is very critical. And therefore, this knowledge is actually not easy to gain. It is actually very, very rare and difficult to obtain. Therefore, even Brahmaji, when he is born into ignorance. And here when we discuss about Brahmaji, there is a pastime in the Kurma Puran. Kurma Puran is the 15th of the Mahapuranas. There are 18 Puranas, and of which Kurma Puran is also one of them. In this discussion of today's Kurma Avatar, we will discuss the pastimes and the lessons from the Samudra Manthan till Kurma Avatar. Then we will discuss about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's pastimes involving Kurma Dev. Also, we'll hear about some more stories of Kurma deities and the prayers that can be offered to Kurma Dev and how it can help in our spiritual life. So here in Kurma Puran, it is explained that Brahmaji, when he was born, there are different versions of Brahmas born in different times, or in one kalpa, when Brahmaji is, one day of Brahma is over, and Brahma's, that night there is total dissolution or partial dissolution, where there is complete flooding. It is said that Brahmaji appears in a golden egg at one time, and then when the night of Brahma comes, when there is total flooding, then Brahmaji is born from the navel of Vishnu again for the next creation. And therefore, when Brahmaji was born from the navel of Vishnu, he asked Vishnu, "Who are you?" Vishnu said, "I am the one in whom entire universes reside." So Brahmaji said, "I am also the creator of the universe. The universe resides in my body. You may come and see, and you may enter my body and see." So Vishnu enters into Brahma's body and sees the entire creation of the universe, entire beings. So when Vishnu comes out, and Vishnu says, "Well, very nice, you can enter my body and also try to see what is there in my form." And when Brahmaji goes into the form of, he sees unlimited universes, he sees total creation, he sees unlimited expanse of the energy of the Supreme Lord, and he is not able to come out. So somehow or other, Vishnu jabs him out from the navel, from his navel, and comes out to that flower again, the navel. And Brahmaji is annoyed because he was not allowed to come out. He felt a little bad. He said, "See, we are both creators of the universe. We have to work cooperatively." So he felt a little bit bad that, you know, he had struggled to come out. He said, "Anyways, for a token of your of this, all this episode that happened, let you be called as my son, Padmaja, my offspring." And that's how Brahmaji is appearing from the root of Vishnu. And therefore, Brahmaji, when encounters any problem which is beyond his capacity, he knows where he has to approach, where the root lies. And therefore, when we are confused way beyond our capacity, we have to turn back to our roots. We may have to go back to the root of our existence, and the root of our existence also rooted in the culture of that existence. And that is how the solution is obtained. So therefore, Brahmaji is now going to go to the Shvetadeep, where there is a planet in this universe where Vishnu resides. And now he goes to the shores of the Shvetadeep planet and invokes the presence of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And he's chanting mantras, and he is not able to see Vishnu at all. But he knows the standard process of seeing Vishnu is to chant and hear. once Jayadev Maharaj had come to one youth program long back ago, and then we had a question answer session, and someone asked a question. So, how can we see God? This is a standard question for all times. Some few days ago, traveling, and a cab driver asked the same question. Swamiji, aapne Bhagwan ko dekha hai? This is a standard question. Because everyone wants to, they don't want to see, but they want to find out that have you seen or not? Have you wasted your life? In short, they want to put an allegation that if you have not seen God, then why are you wasting your life? So they don't want to see God, they want you to realize that you haven't not gained anything. So once the same question was asked to Srila Prabhupada, Prabhupada, have you seen God? Prabhupada said, what difference does it make to you if I have seen or not? Aapko kya farak padega? If I have seen God, if I have eaten something, will your hunger be pacified? So if you are asking, have you eaten? You are hungry and you are asking someone else, have you eaten? But does that make any solution to your hunger? No. You may ask, do you have something to eat? That's a good question. So to ask, you can always understand by the question, what is the intention of the question. If someone is asking, have you seen God? You must understand that that person is trying to tell you that you know, there is no God. Because you haven't seen, and I'm confident of that. I mean, that person is saying, I'm confident of that, you have not seen God. And Prabhupada is saying that, if I have seen God, what difference it makes to you? Will you see by my seeing? For therefore, and Jayadev Maharaj was answering that question in a very a little different way. And he asked that, why do you have to see? Can't you smell? Can't you hear? Can't you feel? So if your question is, can you see? Our question is, we can show you by the process of hearing. We can hear God. Right? And therefore, you can actually see God by the process of hearing. We don't have to depend on only one sense to experience transcendence. In fact, the most incapable sense is the eyesight, because there are so many things that we see, but actually doesn't happen to be like that later on. Arey jo dekha tha wo raha nahi. Or what I saw was not a remember thinking that this was it actually. You can't understand a person by seeing a person. A person may look something to you, but may not be the same person as you will experience that person later on. So do you actually, it's okay, two people to get married, one boy and a girl, they look and they get married. Sometimes in Kali Yuga this happens. Not sometimes, most of the times they look and they marry. But afterwards they find this person has a mind also. And that mind does not match my mind. My eyes matched with her looks, or his looks match my eyes. Very good, very nice. But actually I'm not living with the flesh. I'm living with the mind also. So then people who are on the physical platform, they look, they only see. Someone on the mental platform, they only try to understand by the mind. But someone who is on the spiritual platform actually goes much deeper than these all external layers. And therefore it is so important to actually hear something which is spiritual. And here therefore Brahmaji is offering prayers and Vishnu is responding to those prayers, and the most important thing is that they are invoking the presence of the Supreme Personality of Godhead by the mode of goodness. If we actually want to invoke God in our life, experience God, is only possible through the process of invoking the process of the mode of goodness. And therefore, when Prabhupada went to the West, it is only mode of passion and ignorance, as he was just traveling, he was entering the Boston Harbor, and he sensed the modes of Rajogun and Tamogun, the mode of passion and ignorance, so strong. And he was confident that people will not be able to understand this message. Why? Because they are in the mode of ignorance and passion. And what I am going to give the message is actually purely transcendental. How will that communication take place? What did he pray? He prayed that, may my speaking become understandable to them by your grace. And therefore Srila Prabhupada never relied on his ability to communicate transcendence. I am going to give a talk to them, I am going to say something to them, and why are they not going to understand? They will. Prabhupada said, absolutely they will not. Why? Because the modes are not to the matching. I am going to speak on a different level, they are on a different level. How will this communication take place? And therefore, Prabhupada prayed that let, by your grace, let them understand. But then that grace was given to them, both of them, to Srila Prabhupada as well as those hippies. Those people who were actually the recipients of Prabhupada's great effort and endeavor. Yet, to continue that grace, there had to be a system of mode of goodness. And therefore, after some time of having fed prasadam, so Prabhupada laid one rule and another rule, that this will actually help you to understand. So first yajna that Prabhupada did was the vivaha yajna in the West. It was not diksha yajna also. Why? Because the diksha would not survive without samskar. Diksha also is a samskar. To have the samskar also, you had to have certain level of goodness. And therefore, there are so many samskars that also found the foundation of a good spiritual life. Spiritual life cannot be just accepted on the mode of transcendence. And therefore, there are various samskars that actually lay the foundation. And Kurma Avatar represents the foundation of spiritual life, which are this mode of goodness, which is actually the cultivation of these different samskars. Now all of these samskars are practically lost. Practically three generations have lost clue of these samskars. What is the samskar? What is Garbhadhan samskar? What is Vivaha Yajna? What is the purpose of a marriage? What is to be done post? What kind of samskars to be given to the child? For every sequel, we require seminar, parenting seminar. But this is what actually Arjuna was telling. If this Kula Dharma is destroyed, then how will this tradition which was passed from one generation to the next be continued? And when this tradition stops, then Adharma begins. And therefore it is said, he is saying that when the Kula Striya, they become polluted, that causes the future race to become Varna Sankar. And therefore, the purity of the womanhood was the test of the standard of civilization. And therefore, it is so important that these samskars and this tradition are nicely restored, preserved and propagated through a proper Kula Dharma. Prabhupada mentions in the first chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, his lectures. He is speaking on these classes to this Western audience, but actually becoming more relevant to the Indian audience also now. Why? Because we are also becoming Westernized. We are taking something from them as means of convenience, not as science. So when you try to make only convenience as the only way to lead a life and not science, then what will happen? This foundation will be broken. And therefore here, Brahmaji knows if goodness does not exist, then this universe will go into the hands of those who are in the mode of passion and ignorance, and the future generations will be destroyed. We accept that which is very convenient, which is very quick, which is very which is looks very good, which appears very attractive. But we have lost that impetus to invest in something which is going to go for generations. And therefore, this PD Nirman is so important. Strong generation of children is actually the need of the hour. Every time we have a problem, whenever we go to some program, every parent, what to do with the children? But this question should have been asked long before getting married. You can't write an exam paper when you get in without preparation. How is this answered? You cannot ask someone how to answer this question. You have to leave those questions then. And that's how everyone is just leaving those questions unanswered or writing just whatever they know. And then question paper comes back and to them and they have got less marks. And we see that. And therefore here we find that when this establishment of proper dharma is destroyed, that is what Brahma is worried and he is invoking. And the most strongest conception, the misconception of this lost of tradition is the bodily conception of life, where we only calculate everything as per the body. The first concern of everyone is, anyone is born, ye kya banega? What will this person become? That means, what will this person become to earn? Right? Not to become. That identity is not based on the character, that identity is based on the earning capacity. Because right now the struggle for survival is going on, therefore the impressions on the current generation is only to survive. And therefore these are the only samskars that we have got, how to survive. So we also think, how will this child survive? So for survival, that child needs a degree. Therefore the child needs to go to college. But before college they need a school. But before the school they also need something else. All of this has to go. And therefore we have to work hard to give them that level of education. So therefore education is actually, to Chanakya Pandit says, definition of education, to see every other woman as mother is the standard of education. Right? To see every other's property as actually filth, useless, and to see everybody else's suffering as one's own suffering, these are the parameters of being educated. And therefore, when we lose the principles of culture, the science of tradition, we actually stick to the basic thread of spirituality and we actually struggle to survive for the rest of our life. And therefore, the first is the bodily conception of life, that everyone is thinking about artha. Artha ka bhai hoga to dharma kabhi nahi praap kar paayenge. Parantu jab dharma ka bhai hoga, apne aap artha praapti ho jayegi. If you follow the principles of truth, you will be having all means of livelihood. But if we only think of livelihood, there is no guarantee that you will lead a good life. And therefore, three things are very important: life principles, livelihood, and lifestyle. All these three have to be integrated in one theme, and that has to become the carrier of one's spirituality. So Brahmaji is saying, is Prabhupada mentioning this purport, that invoking Krishna means to reject bodily conception of life and to change the definition of struggle. In fact, this nice purport Srila Prabhupada is also mentioning that people are thinking about the struggle for survival. And this struggle is, Prabhupada is mentioning, the struggle is something for, that is what is called that survival of the fittest. Prabhupada is saying that one who is fit to survive? One who will never die. But we are surviving to die. So how can you call it survival? And how can you call that one is the fittest? So one who will eventually overcome death is actually one who is going to survive. And therefore, when Maharaj Nemi was to perform a sacrifice and Vasishtha Rishi had to be called for the sacrifice, but Vasishtha Rishi said that I am doing a yajna for Indra. So I'll be busy, we may postpone it for some time. And then it so happened that Nimi Maharaj knew the urgency of time, that it is not so easy to wait in this world and be patient to do the right thing. And he said that he called some different Brahmins and carried on the sacrifice. And Vasishtha Rishi came back thinking that I was to be doing this sacrifice. And when he came back, he found that the sacrifice was done. So then there was some altercation between both of them. So Vasishtha Rishi cursed him to die, Nimi Maharaj. Nimi Maharaj also cursed Vasishtha Rishi to die. Both did not survive. Both started with the process of yajna, ended up with defeating the purpose. None of them survived. But then Vasishtha Rishi was born again. He got birth again from Mitra and Varuna, begotten by Urvashi. And he took birth again, but Nimi Maharaj's dead body was kept by the priests. And the priests were trying to invoke his life back again. And he said that, I don't want to take this body anymore again. The very same purpose which I did yajna was to get rid of this body. And therefore I am not going to make my appearance back in this body again. I do not need it. And therefore it shows the strong and Krishna consciousness movement is actually to make everyone fit for survival. This kind of survival, where the soul is not feeling the dependence of the body. The independence on the bodily conception of life is actual independence. And therefore this is possible when one has given up the dictates of kama, krodha and lobha, lust, greed and anger. And this is what Parikshit Maharaj is being encouraged, that you are the one who has given up that and therefore you are fit for such survival. What kind of survival? You have been cursed but still you have not become angered. You have not become angered means you have definitely conquered lust and greed. And therefore you are Surapriya, you are one who is actually dear to Krishna, dear to Vishnu. But asurs or the demons like Kamsa, Ravan and Hiranyakashipu, they worship the devatas, the devis, so as to increase their material opulence and increase their madness more and more. Kamsa was a worshipper of Durga. Hiranyakashipu was worshipper of Brahma and Ravan was worshipper of Shiva. All of them three were devout worshippers, but they envied Vishnu and therefore they had to lose everything. Therefore envy to Vishnu is the cause of the living entity's fall down, and therefore it is so important that one should associate with strong spiritual sound vibration and bring in one's life the conduct free from kama, krodha and lobha. And therefore when this verse is explained, then after communicating to Brahma, Brahma communicating to Vishnu, Vishnu responds by a deep voice resembling the rumbling of the clouds. And as soon as they hear Vishnu, they actually don't see him at all. They actually just hear him. And Brahmaji says just that As one can derive fire from wood, milk from the milk back of the cow, food, grains and water from land, and prosperity in one's livelihood from industrial enterprises, so by the practice of bhakti yoga, even within this material world, one can achieve your favor or intelligently approach you. Those who are pious all affirm this. So, in this verse, the cultivation of bhakti yoga is explained by when one can actually invoke the presence of Vishnu. What is that bhakti yoga? The explanation is given by these three analogies. And these three analogies become actually the foundation of the principle of invoking. These three analogies are not redundant analogies pointing to some analogy for the sake of comparison, but this analogy itself contained that principle. How? By deriving fire from wood. That means by friction one can get fire from wood, and by digging the earth one can get food, grains and water. One has to dig grains, get food and water. And Prabhupada mentions that one should get milk from the milk back of the cows. And very nice purport is explanation here. Prabhupada said milk is compared to nectar, because why we are talking about milk here? Because in the churning of the milk ocean, the churning also happening in the milk ocean also. You have to understand that there has to be so much milk. Right? We haven't idea of so much idea of milk. Right now we have only the idea of milk, but we have not seen the quantity of milk. It's a milk ocean. It's not a milk dairy where we have a huge cauldron of, say, like 1,000, 2,000, 10,000, 20,000. It's a milk ocean. And even when Yama is asking question to Yudhishthir to define what is Amrit, Yudhishthir Maharaj says, milk is nectar. Milk is Amrit. And therefore, Prabhupada is mentioning that milk is compared to nectar. We are going to churn the milk ocean and get the nectar. But right now we have no milk ocean, so at least we can churn the milk back of the cows and get milk at least. Because we don't have that much capacity to churn the milk ocean because there are no cows. In 1947, after so-called independence of India, as Prabhupada said, that there were, for one person there were 10 cows. That means the population of cows were 10 times the population of the human beings, citizens in India. And now it is less than one cow per 10 persons. And it is said that the cow is called mother. Why? Because the mother doesn't continue to feed the child throughout the life, milk. It is the cow who gives the milk to a human being throughout the life. And therefore, the cow is not considered, she is mother. If we have connection to milk, then we can know what is mother. Right? A child who has not been fed milk does not know the value of mother. And therefore, that is actually very valuable nectar. It's medicine. And therefore, Prabhupada said, milk is compared to nectar, which one can drink to become immortal. We are not even going to churn the milk ocean today's discussion. We are just going to stop at Kurma. Churning is going to go on. But still we can get the nectar before the churning. What is that churning? What is that nectar? Prabhupada said, milk. You don't have to churn the nectar of the milk ocean. You only have to get the milk to become immortal. This is enough for Kali Yuga. If people only can drink milk, they can become immortal. How? Prabhupada is explaining very nicely. So there are some simple ways to become immortal. Of course, simply drinking milk will not make one immortal. Right? So it's clarifying. Just drinking, I have become immortal now. Huh? Of course, simply drinking milk will not make one immortal, but it can increase the duration of one's life. If we really think that human form of life is short, otherwise there is no problem. You can avoid drinking milk. So it said that therefore it can increase the durations of one life. In modern civilization, men do not think milk to be important because it's propagated that way, and therefore they do not live very long. Although in this age men can live up to 100 years, their duration of life is reduced because they do not drink large quantities of milk. Can you imagine this challenge given by Srila Prabhupada to the whole civilization, including us devotees? We don't have to drink milk. We used to wonder why these children don't used to drink milk in the beginning. Actually, that was never milk. It was all adulterated poison. And definitely, they were so sensitive to understand that. And therefore, they didn't want to drink it. And therefore, Prabhupada says, you can live 100 years in Kali Yuga, provided you drink large quantities of milk. We recently visited a very nice cow shelter, Goshala, where there was a person who was serving cows so scientifically. He was not just keeping cows, he was actually maintaining their gotra also, right? Maintaining their lineage. And in one species of cows, there were 16 gotras. That means 16 different traditions, different lineages. That means each cow will have a different family tree. 16 family trees. And he has maintained that so nicely. And he was saying that he knows of one person, his friend, who only drinks milk and eats nothing for life. Just drinks milk. And he was tested for any deficiency of protein, calcium or vitamins or anything. And his diagnosis or his reports were better than the other ones. So if Vashishta Rishi had only Kamdhenu, sorry that, I forget the name of Surabhi Kamdhenu. That milk was not only for drinking, that also milk was performed for yajna. So imagine if one person had one cow and a little land, didn't have to go for a job, didn't have to search for, had to hunt for trains and get into trains and jump there and jump here and, you know, catch the bus. No, somehow, if you just make a movie of a person, you know, starting from home, and you just fast forward a little bit, maybe looking like monkeys, jumping from this and, you know, on the train, hanging everywhere. No trees, but at least hanging on buses and trains. So this has become monkey civilization. Why? Because we have given up the means of livelihood, which were so natural, beneficial. We went to get the modern civilization. And therefore, Prabhupada said, we are here in these cities for some time, as long as people are living here. But actually, our business is not to stick here. We have to show people the ideal way of civilization. And therefore, Prabhupada said this around 35, 40 years ago, that if we do this, the whole world will follow us. The whole world will follow the Krishna consciousness movement because it provides a tangible solution to the human problems of life. And Prabhupada says that this is a sign of Kali Yuga, that people don't drink milk. In Kali Yuga, instead of drinking milk, people prefer to slaughter an animal and eat its flesh. And therefore Prabhupada says that this is what is explained here, that how one can become immortal. So Prabhupada says that one should take ample milk and thus prolong one's life. One can prolong one's life, develop his brain, execute devotion service, and ultimately attain the favor of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Right. So one should take milk, prolong one's life, and then one should develop one's brain by drinking milk. And by that one can execute devotion service very nicely. And Prabhupada says, as it is essential to get food grains and water by digging the earth, it is also essential to give protection to cows and take nectar and milk from their milk bags. And Prabhupada is mentioning, people are taking to industrial enterprises for comfortable living, but they refuse to endeavor to execute devotion service by which they can achieve the ultimate goal of life by returning home back to Godhead. And therefore, He's saying that forgetting this aim of life, they are working very hard in disappointment and frustration. Moga asha, moga karmana, moga jnana vichetasa. The so-called vaishyas, the industrialists and businessmen are involved in big, big industrial enterprises, but they are not interested in food grains and milk. However, as indicated here, by digging for water even in the desert, we can produce food grains. And when we produce food grains and vegetables, we can give protection to cows. While we giving protection to cows, we can draw abundant quantities of milk. And by getting enough milk and combining it with food grains and vegetables, we can prepare hundreds of nectarian foods. The whole blueprint of our civilization is given in this one paragraph. We can happily eat this food and thus avoid industrial enterprises and joblessness. He has spoken this 40 years ago. And this is more true than any other time of this age. And Prabhupada saying, finally, agriculture and cow protection are the way to become sinless and thus be attracted to devotional service. That means the way Brahma Purvata Prasannatma na shochati na kaunchi sama sarveshu, and the shloka explains that one who actually becomes sinless, becomes free from all sins, can actually execute devotional service very easily. And the way to become sinless is actually two ways, agriculture and cow protection. Those who are sinful cannot be attracted by devotional service. And thus, this very nice purport concludes and explains that just like this is the process of bhakti yoga. Bhakti yoga is a process which has various support systems, and therefore, along with chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, as is required to invoke the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the means to chant Hare Krishna and to improve the consciousness, the basic elements of life are food, grains and milk. If you combine that, milk is nectar, food and grains and milk is more delicious. And therefore you are happy, satisfied, and you are liberating yourself. So therefore, this is, and as soon as Vishnu is going to say, in fact, Brahmaji says, you already know what is our problem. We don't have to tell what is our problem. All these hymns, Brahmaji never said, we have a problem, please solve it. We have a problem, please solve it. And therefore, Vishnu says, your time has not come. Kalena. Kalena and Kavyena. Kalena indicates time and Kalena indicates Shukracharya. And Lord says, the time is not ripe, the logic has to be used. When the time is not ripe, that the snake and mouse logic, now you got a snake enters the mouse, the mice's hole, goes, in fact, a basket, in fact, the whole story is explained that snake and mouse actually got trapped in a basket. The mouse says, is telling that, you know, help us, you pierce that basket and we can escape, and I can, we can actually run. But in fact, in the whole process is that the snake eats the mouse after it pierces the basket. And similarly, the snake also enters the mice's hole, kills the mice and stays in that same rat's hole. So Vishnu is saying, you have lost your kingdom. Now only thing is that you have to use the snake-mouse logic. So you are on a disadvantaged side. What should you do? You should try to give them the proposal to produce the nectar and involve the benefit of both the demons and demigods. And when this come, and never become, be patient and peaceful and not greedy, that things are not coming. And this way you will be able to attain it. And this way the devatas go to Bali Maharaj. Bali Maharaj is welcoming them. Diplomatically they have given this process. And they all agree. And they all go to the shore of the milk ocean. And they have decided to bring the Mandara mountain. And the Mandara mountain is made of gold. They lifted it, but they could not hold it. After losing its grip, all of them get crushed under the Mandara mountain and they lose their life. they have tried so hard, they only attempted to do the instructions of Vishnu, but they were not becoming successful. So what happened? Garuda, Vishnu came riding on Garuda and he put the mountain, he glanced over all of them, brought them back to life, just like Krishna brought back by his glance the coward boys who actually lost their life drinking the water of Yamuna, poisoned by Kalia. And similarly, when Rama, he glanced over the monkeys who were dead and all of them were brought back to life. So therefore, one has to be sure of Krishna's protection. And therefore, the devatas, when they did it, they were sure that Vishnu will come to rescue, but they had to do their best. After doing their best and having failed, then Vishnu comes to help. We may not ask for Lord's help before it becomes our full attempt. And therefore, Garuda takes Vishnu and all the devatas along with Mandar Mountain to the center of the Milk Ocean. At every stage of time, there is Vishnu always intervening at critical stages. So, this is enterprise, Udyog. A devotee is required to do some kind of an endeavor. Atyahara prayasascha prajalpo niyamagraha. It is said atyahara, but atyahara also means that alpa, cheshta, also is a detriment in devotional service. One may avoid excess, but one may also avoid under effort. Alpa cheshta, that means not trying one's full capacity. And therefore, after doing all of them, these demons have taken the tail, the demigods have taken the head part, and they're churning. The Mandar, the Vasuki has the rod, the snake Vasuki. And as soon as snake Vasuki is the rod, Vishnu says, Garuda, you leave. Because two devotees of a different nature should not be in one place. Right? Otherwise that creates clashes. Why? Because the nature is, therefore we have been given Swabhava. A Swabhava is very important. One has to deal with one's Swabhava and other Swabhava also, one's nature. Otherwise, there will be difficulty if we don't understand the swabhav of people, because that's also the swadharma of the person. So Vishnu is giving the swadharma of a person and engaging according to one's own swadharma. And therefore this is happening and the demons are thinking that I've got tail, they've got head, that is superior. So demons are always thinking that to do opposite of the demigods is the right thing to do. So they exchange. And after exchanging, they find that the Vasuki is throwing huge vapors of after being thoroughly squeezed for the churning, all the black soot of poison from Vasuki's mouth is burning and actually tainted all the bodies of demons black. So this is how the churning takes place, but after churning of some time they find that the Mandar mountain is sinking. And as it was sinking, they were unable to rescue it back and they could not any longer continue to churn. And as soon as it happened, the Lord Vishnu appeared again. In fact, Vishnu was churning. This Samudra Manthan has the maximum number of avatars in one project. First comes Vishnu to churn, then comes Kurma avatar, then comes Ajit incarnation, then comes Dhanvantari, then comes Mohini Murti. So how many incarnations required? It was a colossal project. So many incarnations had to come. But the foundation was Kurma avatar. Nothing could have become successful without a strong foundation. And therefore, without a strong foundation in a person's spiritual life, it will be always difficult to get the nectar of bhakti. And therefore, one has to make sure that foundation is set up very nicely. And therefore, as soon as the churning took place and they could not any longer come there. The demigods, the praying, as soon as mountain was sinking, the Lord Vilokya Vignesha Vidhum Tadeshvara Duranta Viryo Vitatabha Siddhandi Kritva Vapu Kachapam Adbhut Mahat Pravishyatoyam Grim Ujjara. That the Lord appeared in the form of tortoise and with great determination, whose determination is infallible, Duranta Viryo. His determination is infallible, everything was failing. But still, Vishnu kept inspiring. The mode of goodness means to keep on going on without losing hope and without losing determination. So the tortoise entered the water and lifted the great Mandar hill. So it is said that this pastime is actually, the main purpose for the pastime is actually for the Lord's pleasure, for the Lord's Leela. And the purpose or the significance of this pastime is that the Lord represents the foundation, and the stability and the ability of Kurma Avatar means to give stability to foundation of devotees' vows. The Vrata of Vaishnavas, Kurma Dev gives strong foundation, and therefore Bhakti Siddhanta Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, while in Bhakti Bhavan in near Mayapur, in fact, they discovered the deity of Kurmadev while digging, and at that time he gave this deity of Kurmadev to his son Bimal Prasad to worship. Why? Because at young age of 7, this deity of Kurmadev was given to Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Ravi Thakur to worship. Why? It would give a strong foundation and stability to taking vows. And therefore, devotees worship Kurmadev to develop strong vows and to maintain these vows of determination. In fact, there is a whole pastime of Kurma Shetra. There are two deities of Kurmadev very prominently in Andhra Pradesh. And one of them is in Kurma Shetra. We visited that temple a long back ago in a yatra, I guess in 1999, and this pastime was narrated by His Holiness Radhanath Swami Maharaj of the pastime of that deity. And it's a very interesting pastime, how the Lord protects the devotee's vow. It was the place of Shvetachal, where the king Shveta Chakravarti was the king. Ekadashi, it was the time of Ekadashi that his wife Vishnu Priya was observing vows and doing puja to Lord Vishnu. And he approached his wife for satisfying his lusty desires, and she was trying to evade it and trying to pray to Lord Vishnu to protect her vow of performing Ekadashi without engaging in this abominable act. So then on her prayers, Vishnu appeared and Kurmadev appeared and ordered Ganga Devi to chase the king. And the king was chased, there was flooding of Ganga, and it followed the king everywhere till the king went to the top of the Shvetachal mountain. He somehow other survived, asked this minister, the minister told him about the greatness of his wife's devotion. He felt ashamed and he wanted to do tapasya for atonement. And he did tapasya, he actually met Narad Muni. Narad Muni told him to do tapasya and gave the Kurma mantra to chant. And he chanted Kurma mantra and stood in one single toe from morning till evening, in summer, in middle of fire, in rainy season, drenched in rain, in cold, stood there for 300 years. Post that, Narad Muni, he actually collapsed. Narad Muni came there and requested the Lord to give darshan. And Lord Vishnu gave darshan in the form of Kurma Dev to this king, four-handed form. And they all together went to the rishi's place, and the king was actually wanting to take bath in a kund. He was very much fatigued. So Kurma Dev actually used this chakra, and with this chakra he created a kund. And Mahalakshmi appeared and said, "Why have you appeared in this abominable place? There is no good place in this area." So he, on the request of Narad Muni invoked and installed the deity of Kurmadev. The king requested Narad Muni and they installed the deity of Kurmadev, whose installation was done by Brahma and all the other demigods who came there. And that deity is still worshipped by the descendants of Madhvacharya. Sripad Ramacharya, when he came, when he was in Jagannath Puri and he was questioning the mode of deity worship and were not following Panch Ratriki Vidhi, Jagannath ji deported Ramanacharya to Kurmakshetra. As soon as he went to Kurmakshetra, he found this deity and thought it was Shivlinga, and he fasted for a day, but found it actually it had some legs, and found it was not a Shivlinga, it was a Kurma deity, and he was happy, and he worshipped Kurmadev, and he installed the deities of Sri Devi and Bhudevi. And thereafter, Madhvacharya's descendants have been worshipping that beautiful deity of Kurmadev. And this is how the Lord protects the vows of a devotee and gives stability to the foundation of a devotee's vows. In fact, there's a prayer in the fifth canto praying to Kurmadev to save one from the falling in the hellish planets. That means to save one from fall down, also one has to get the blessings of Kurmadev. And it is also mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam that while the churning was going on, it was a very nice sensation that Kurmadev was feeling, the itching sensation. So the itching sensation was giving pleasure to Kurmadev. And it is Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati mentions in one of his commentaries that this is the pastime of Kurmadev, where the itching sensation represents the mental speculation and the sense gratification tendencies of the jivas. By worshipping Kurmadev, one can get relieved from the itching of the mental speculation and the itching of the desires for sense gratification, and one will be relieved with the, and thus the breath that was coming out from Kurmadev's nostrils created the waves in the ocean. And therefore the waves of the ocean start to follow the frequency of the breath of Kurmadev. So whenever you see the waves of the ocean, remember Kurmadev's breathing. And that's how the rhythm has come from Kurmadev's breath. But that breath has to be meditated upon. What is the meditation? One has to meditate on the pastimes of Kurmadev, which will blow with the breath of Kurmadev into one's heart the favorable breeze to inspire spiritual advancement, to ventilate the heart which is now filled with the dust of anarthas, to cleanse that with the breeze of the breath, the blowing of the breath of Kurmadev. And this is what we pray to Kurmadev, to give stability and foundation to devotees' vows, to protect one from falling down to hellish planets, to relieve us from the itching sensation, and to breathe the breeze of pure nectar of their pastimes into our dirty hearts. And therefore also represents the turning within. Therefore the Bhagavad Gita also mentions that yada samharate chayam kurma kurmang angani va sarvashah indriyani indriyarthe bhyas tasya pragya pratishthita. That means one who has withdrawn the senses within when they are not in need and only use them for the sake of serving Krishna is exactly what a tortoise does. So Kurmadev also represents the intelligence to be given to a devotee when to withdraw one's senses and how to activate the senses in engaging in the service of the Lord. And therefore these are the beautiful purposes, the significance of the Kurmadev, the foundation, the protection, the relief from the itching sensation, the ventilation of one's heart by blowing the breath, and also the the introspection which is awarded to a devotee by proper development of intelligence. And therefore, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also visited this Kurma Kshetra. He visited the Kurma Brahman, the Brahman who was told to study and stay in one place and chant and deliver everybody by spreading Krishna consciousness. There are two places where Mahaprabhu has gone to a particular place again, very quickly, back again. It is the Kurma Kshetra, and one is the Kurma Kshetra and other is Madurai, Southern Mathura, Dakshin Mathura. So that is the Kurma Brahman, actually the place where, close to Kurma Kshetra is where Vasudev the leper, after he went there, he delivered him. And when Vasudev the leper wanted to take darshan of Mahaprabhu, Mahaprabhu came back again. And this one devotee, Ramdas Vipra, when he went to Southern Mathura or Dakshin Mathura, he found this Brahman, Ramdas Vipra, when he invited him for lunch, when he went and came back to his lunch, the lunch was not ready. And Ramdas Vipra said, "What? Why?" He questioned him, "It is noon time, it's time for lunch." And he said that ingredients have not yet come. We are waiting for the ingredients. Why? Because it's a forest. Actually not a forest, it was actually the meditation that is a forest. And Lakshman has not come back with the ingredients. And therefore Sita Devi is waiting to cook. So in that meditation it took him 3 hours. At 3 o'clock he managed to make the meal offered to Mahaprabhu, but he did not eat, he was fasting. Why was he fasting? Because he was very much unhappy that Sita Devi, the goddess of fortune, was touched by Ravan and kidnapped by her, by him, and he could not even tolerate that incidence. So in that unhappiness he was fasting. Mahaprabhu said in the Vedic scriptures it is mentioned that the goddess of fortune could never be touched by any materialistic person. In fact that was the Maya Sita. So he pacified him and then told him to stop the fasting and eat. But then when Mahaprabhu went to Rameshwaram Dhanush Tirtha, he found a copy of Kurma Puran. How much Kurma is here now, connection. So Kurma Puran, Kurma Kshetra, and now Kurma Puran coming back to Madurai. And he coming back and found a copy of Kurma Puran where it is mentioned that Agni Devi received Sita Devi before the kidnapping, and the Maya Sita was what Ravan kidnapped. And when the test was taken, it was Agni Dev who gave back the original Sita, and the Maya Sita entered Agni. This made Mahaprabhu so happy. He knew it, but he wanted to pacify Ramdas Vipra, that this devotee will be relieved. So he made a copy of the Kurma Puran, took the original and gave the copy there, took the original in such ecstasy, went back to Ramdas Vipra and gave him the evidence, by which he was so pacified and happy. So actually Mahaprabhu, through Kurma Puran, made devotees firmly convinced in the faith in scriptures, the faith in Vaishnava Tattva, in faith in Bhagavat Tattva. And this is the purpose of worshipping Kurma Avatar, for a strong foundation in Tattva, in the vows and in introspection, and in relieving us from the itching sensation of sense gratification. And these are the wonderful, some wonderful pastimes of Kurma Dev. And if this meditation is there in our lives, probably our life will have a strong foundation of the samskars, the proper lifestyle, the life principle, the life livelihood, as Prabhupada mentioned, the sinless livelihoods of taking care of cows and actually serving the Mother Earth with great care, and achieving the nectar for having a long span with good brains and with a strong devotional execution. And this is how we celebrate the wonderful appearance of Kurma Avatar. And the Srimad Bhagavatam goes on how the nectar is produced, but before the nectar there is poison. So therefore the foundation is strong, then we can take anything that comes thereafter. Hare Krishna. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. So there are few announcements. First of all, we would like to welcome all the guests who have come to our Sunday feast program for the very first time. सबसे पहले हम उन सभी अतिथियों का स्वागत करेंगे जो आज पहली बार हमारे मंदिर में आए हैं. Our reception team of devotees, they will be standing near Hanuman ji Arch Vigra, will welcome